section I'd like to move to then is the least squares section, and we're going to spend a few parts of this topic and hopefully uncover some interesting things about least squares that you didn't know before and clear up some misconceptions about least squares that you currently have. Okay, so if you didn't get a chance to print out these notes, it's not too big of a problem because of this next 20 minutes are really just basic overview. But we will learn about two concepts that you may not quite be familiar with. But before we get to that, let's just understand where we're going with this section. Well, least squares is something that you've heard of probably two main times before. And I'm hazarding a guess based on previous classes experience that whatever you've learned, you've probably learned some serious problems. You've learned in a way that's probably not appropriate. You've got some serious problems with understanding of these squares. One of which is the most obvious is the use of R squared as a way to judge whether you've got a good model. So I'm going to show you in this class that R squared is really pretty much a waste of time to judge whether a model is of any value. What we'll also learn about is learn about prediction intervals, because arguably one of the more useful thing of a least squares model is to make predictions on. So we would like to have prediction bounds, lower bounds and upper bounds. And then the other interesting aspects that we're going to learn about is how do you do build regression models where you've got variables that are in your model that are categorical. So for example, male, female, or high school, university, middle school, PhD. So there's a categorical variable with four levels. How do we use models with variables of those types? Okay, because we will encounter those in the area. And the other good reason for putting these squares here is our next section on design of experiments relies totally on these squares to build and analyze the theory of these models. So it's a crucial step to get clear on now. So you've probably seen examples similar to this if you've been on a co-op term. How do you measure, for example, the yield from a batch and relate that yield to the purity of the raw material? So you measure the yield coming out of the batch. Can you relate that to the input variable, the sucrose purity? And then you might determine that, yes, you can predict that yield plus or minus 8%. So one of our focuses is how to get that plus or minus 8%. What does that mean? You might also want to know that a very valid question is, can you relate yield to glucose purity, for example, different inputs? And you need to be able to look at the data and say, no, there's no relationship between those two variables. How do you come to that conclusion that yes, either a variable does affect the output, the purity, or whether it doesn't affect. In fact, that answer right there is due to a confidence interval. We're going to build confidence intervals for the slopes, and we're going to say whether that slope has a statistically significant effect on the model or not. How do we get to that confidence interval? Another way that we can look at this is to understand the relationships between two variables. So whether that relationship is linear or non-linear might be something that we're really interested in. We'll use these squares to uncover those relationships and build models to relate those two variables. Then if you look at this theoretical model for these squares, you see that it is formed either B0 plus B1x or beta 0 plus beta 1x, whatever notation you're comfortable with. We're going to understand what is a confidence interval for those two really mean. Why do we care about them? What does R squared actually tell us? And then how do we build predictions from those models? Those are some of the most useful things we want from our regression models. Okay, so we'll spend a few classes on that, and most of that will come into this right away. So in tomorrow's class, we'll start to look at some of that already. Today's class will be correlation and covariance. And then next week, we'll start to move on to these other topics. Regression models with more than two variables, with nonlinear terms, we've got categorical variables, And we'll look at a little bit of correlation with causality as well. I put some references over there. This first one is a little bit of a math-oriented book, but it's also very readable. It's actually written by another professor here at Mac, sociology, which is an excellent graduate level course on these squares. And some of the material in this section of the course I've taken from some of his textbooks and some of his books. So I do recommend that book. And in fact, he's also the author of the Car Life. So let's step back here for a minute and build two important concepts that we need to build on over the next class. One is covariance, one is correlation. And you've heard, likely you've heard about correlation, right? Yeah, correlation is a term that you're familiar with. But covariance might not be, but it is also important to understand. So let's take an engineering example. We know from the ideal gas law, pressure times the volume is equal to the number of moles times R times the gas constant T. So let's fix some variables. If I fix my volume to 20 liters, I fix the number of moles to be about 1 kilogram of chlorine gas, so 14 moles of gas, and there's my gas constant R. So I've got fixed V, fixed N, fixed R. So my only two variables I'm considering are P, the pressure, and the temperature. If I rewrite that P equals nRT, I can write it as P equals beta 1 times T. I'm going to build a relationship between pressure and temperature with the coefficient beta 1. So if I go do that, I might easily do that by measuring the temperature in the gas cylinder at various pressures. And we see that we get our expected relationship between the two variables. As the temperature goes up, the pressure in the cylinder. Now I also happen to measure the humidity at the same time. There's a third variable I measure. The humidity in the room that I'm doing this experiment can also be recorded. I record the mean variance for those three columns. Now the definition for covariance is this messy looking expression up there. It says take the expected value of one variable x, subtract off the mean, multiply the other variable y, and then calculate the expected value. So let's just take a look and unpack that a little bit. In this case, we're referring to x as temperature and y as pressure. So what we see there, in fact, in the brackets are deviation variables. We subtract off the mean for each case. So that's now a new variable, t minus t bar, creates a new variable in deviation form. And in fact, if we calculate the mean of t minus t bar, it's going to have a mean of 0. But what we do is we calculate these deviation variables and then multiply the individual deviations. So if you go try this at home, there's your temperature data. The mean is 327. So your first deviation variable is 273 minus 327. That's your temperature deviation. And your pressure deviation is 1600. Minus 1910, average pressure. So then multiply those two deviations by each other, and you'll then in fact get this number over here, 16740. And you repeat down the rest of the column, copy and paste your formula in Excel, MATLAB, and you can go calculate those new values of those products of the deviations. With that operator coding, says simply calculate the average value of that vector. So there's the average value of the vector 6780. And that's your covariance. So it's not a very useful number, I'll argue, but it's what covariance means. It's the product of the individual deviations, so its units are also the units of the two variables, so Kelvin and KPa is the two things. So we can't use that. It doesn't mean too much to us. Now, if I repeat that same exercise, except this time I calculate the covariance between temperature and humidity, I get a new number. With again, 4 units of Kelvin multiplied by percentage. The only thing you can say about covariance is that small numbers close to zero means that there's low or small relationship between the two variables. And large values means that there's a high relationship, a strong relationship between the variables. That's pretty much the extent of it. But there's no scale. Like, I can't tell you numbers above 10,000 are really strong covariances. And the reason for that is because if I go to change my units, that number would also go change. And so the shortcoming of covariance is that it only depends on the units of the measurement that I'm using. And we don't like those sorts of metrics. So what we go to do then is go change that covariance and we'll use a correlation instead. But before we go ahead and look at correlation, consider the following cases. What might be the covariance between the hours worked per week? Consider various people in this room or people in society in general. Calculate the covariance if you knew the number of hours that they worked per week and you also knew the amount of salary that you got. What would be the covariance of those two numbers? High value, low value?
Positive and negative.
So correlation is more useful, and the way you can interpret correlation, I like to consider it as co-relationship. So what is the relationship between two variables? It simply takes the covariance, the covariance in the numerator, and we rescale it. And we simply divide through by the variance of x, multiply by the variance of y, and take the square root of that product. So what that does for us is it actually removes the units. We get a dimensionless result. Now remember, variance of x is units of x squared. Variance of y is units of y squared. The square root then takes care of that that raises the power of 2, and we get a cancellation in our units, and we get a dimensionless number that now ranges between minus 1 at the most extreme and plus 1 at the other extreme. So if I had to calculate for you the correlation now between the temperature and pressure in those data that I had originally, we get 0.997. The other thing about correlation is that it's symmetrical. The correlation between pressure and temperature is also the same value. And then finally, the correlation between temperature and humidity, that was 0.38. Those two variables were totally unrelated to each other. There was no relationship between the temperature in the gas cylinder versus the humidity in the room. Yet I got a number of 0.38. So one thing I want to emphasize here is that correlations really are not easy to interpret as well. How high do you have to go before you can say that correlation is significant? In some situations, a correlation of about 0.4 units would really be significant and important to a company. In other cases, that's indicating that it's really of little value. Again, I want to emphasize, so you can start thinking about this, that the relationship between two variables as measured by this RxY is really of little value. Here's where the problem comes with u squared, that r squared is simply that number squared. So this number, r squared up, you get your typical r squared value, you've seen your regression output. That number has fairly little utility in assessing the relationship between two variables. We'll talk a little bit more about r squared in the other class from now on, just to build out the number. So, it may not come out quite as clearly on the slides as it is, hopefully a little clearer on both slides in front of you. But here's various instances of R squared. So there's R, sorry, not R squared, the correlation I should say. Here's a negative correlation of 0.9. Negative 0.9. So you can still see even with minus 0.9, there's a fair amount of scatter around. Here's a plot of correlation, minus 0.15. So there isn't really any trend observable in that area. Here's a positive trend, a moderately positive correlation of about 0.5 units. Here's an interesting one. Notice there is a relationship between the two variables. There's a quadratic relationship, but the correlation is minus 0.17. So this correlation between, compare this correlation, minus 0.17 versus the one above it. They're roughly the same number, minus 0.15, minus 0.17. Yet there's no discernible relationship between those two variables, x and y. Here there is very much a relationship between x and y, but the correlation is still the same. One plot that really helps put that in perspective for you is this one from Wikipedia that shows various correlation values. This correlation of plus 1, a straight line essentially. The correlation of plus 0.8, which is found from 0.40, is simply a scatter of points. There's no discernible relationship between those two variables. And then the relationships become more and more negatively correlated. Here's an interesting example of correlations of plus 1. Plus 1 doesn't necessarily mean there's a 45-degree line between the data. You can also get a correlation of plus 1 various angles, so those 3 points over there, and then correlation of minus 1 with those two graphs. And then this final row is kind of just for fun, but but it indicates correlation all of zero, yet there is some significant structure in those data. So the point for this graph is the correlation zero does not imply no structure in data. When you think of correlation zero, you might have that picture in your head. That doesn't mean, that's not the only way you can get a correlation zero. Correlation zero also means on other ways. And then one final plot just to end off with is this one here that we considered in the second assignment. Here we've got a positive correlation between the two variables from 2001 to 2008. And then from about 2009 on, we have a negative correlation. So one thing you can go do is go measure what that correlation is by taking more data and plotting the red line versus the blue line. And then you can go plot this correlation again in the second line. So think about that. We'll continue with the discussion.